inspire others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, you are a leader. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I, Hina Singh, student manager of BIMHRD, feels deeply honored to introduce Mr. Kavendra Pant amongst us today. Mr. Kavendra Pant, a certified competency assessor, holds a master's degree in personnel management and industrial relations from Nagpur University. He is also certified in psychometric assessments. His career has spanned across the insurance, logistics, and oil and gas sectors with experience spanning over 19 years, including merger and acquisition and organizational restructuring. He climbed his ladder with First Mail Couriers Limited as personnel administrator in the year 1999, followed by regional manager HR in TNT India Travel Limited. Subsequently, he was associated with HDFC Ergo General Insurance as a senior manager HR and rejoined TNT India Travel Limited as manager employee relations. Furthermore, he also contributed in Shapoorji Palanji Infrastructure and Mahanagar Gas Limited as Deputy General Manager, Human Resource. Presently, he is heading HR, IT, Corporate Communications for Shapoorji Palanji Oil and Gas Private Limited in India, Singapore and Malaysia. Sir, I welcome with you with high glory and spirit. Now, I request you to enlighten our spirit with your words of wisdom. The dais is all yours.
Good afternoon, managers. Or rather, I should say that to be managers. I firmly believe that some of you probably over a period of time will replace some of the people like me who are getting old. And probably you will see your predecessors in the campus will see more of people like us from the corporate side. And so it will become a cycle like you will be moving on to the corporates and we people would like to come back to the campuses in terms of what we have learned, what we have gained through the enormous experiences over a period of time from various organizations and various situations. So today I have been given or I have been asked to speak on probably some of the one of the most difficult of the topics which talks about the future, primarily futures of futuristic trends in the business scenario, what industry expects from the future managers, and how to how expertise and skills can be enhanced to suit the business requirements. Probably before I start or before I move on to the topic, I would like to give a disclaimer that these thoughts what I'm projecting, these are purely mine and nothing to do with any of the organizations that I've worked on or wherever I've worked in. But I'll be drawing in instances from wherever we have worked upon and whatever experiences I've gained. So I'll be using those examples or those instances to make the discussion healthier. And so, talking about the future, probably in my opinion, probably three kind of people predict the future or talk about the future. One of them is astrologers, the other ones are fiction writers, and the third ones are primarily the scientists, which do a hell lot of research and use the data to predict the future. And I'm none of them. And moreover, I'm the Nostradamus of the world, which can predict the future, like Nostradamus was predicted the future almost around 400 years back. So I'll try to do justice to the topic based on my experience and based on my tenure with various organizations, based on the situation that I've faced and what I've handled. So before we move on to the topic, it is important that we understand the history and how we have evolved. Of late, we can talk about last three, four decades. of the industrial revolution and the development of the organizations or the businesses over a period of time. But to begin with, I would like to go back to the history when we talk about Darwin's theory. And Darwin, in the initial, in his theory, has projected survival of the fittest. Although I was the first one to hate him, that the guy has died and probably has given us the theory to learn. So probably we use all kinds of abuses and everything possible at that point in time when we used to be students. When we talk about today's business scenario, the Darwin's theory also applies to what we are today and what we are doing in the business organizations today. What he said, can anyone recollect during his school days that what Darwin said? Yeah, he said survival of the fittest. And that's what is happening in the today's business scenario or business organizations. The one which is the most suited organization for today's population or today's business environment will survive, and rest all will get wiped out. Just to take you back to the now, to the recent past or recent history, what has happened over a couple of decades or rather 3-4 decades? I'll use very most simplest of the examples, not those kind of examples which are very high on jargons or something. All of you must have seen during your very childhood days or in some of the movies, old movies rather, I should say, black and white or early days of color movies. You would have seen that whenever people used to travel, they used to carry a suitcase which was made of aluminium, so which were being called as a trunk. And that was the essential part of travel or every household to store things. Yes? But what happened to that industry? And that was a flourishing industry. Every organization was having, every city was having those businesses across. All of a sudden, mindset changed, technology changed, and they vanished. Probably since we are in 2017, you all must have been born in the 90s.
Yes.
And I'm sure that none of you would have seen the telephones with ring dialers. Or probably even if you are, you would have seen either in in a museum or in a movie, not at home. Okay, so those are antiques nowadays, by the way. So probably you can preserve it for another 10 years and you will get a decent cost for that. Same thing happened with a major giant in music industry which is known as HMV, His Master's Voice. I don't know why it was called as His Master's Voice. It was a gender bias to me in today's scenario if you talk. The business which flourished with the phones or the telephone revolution in India, the PCO business. Yes, there were hundreds of PCOs all across. And everything, and now we don't see it over a period of time. So why this has happened? Because there is a transition from one technology to another, and there is a change in the mindset as well. And people are looking for convenience. So there are various factors which actually impact the business. And when we talk about these kind of seminars or thought processes, probably look at various jargons. Today I can talk about the latest trend which we talk about Teslas and all, electronic vehicles or electric vehicles. We can talk about the latest mode of transportation which is coming up in form of what do we call it? Loop or something. Hyperloop. So that also we can talk about, but probably that we'll be predicting about the future, that how how it will shape up and how it will talk about, and that to in a place like India, which even we are talking about installing or implementing or putting bullet trains on track. So there are some factors which definitely impact the business organization. So these, if you ask me, I'll certainly categorize it into the internal and external environment or internal and external factors which impact the businesses. So when we talk about internal, we can talk about the process orientation, quality management, resource and cost optimization, technological upgradation, market research, and customer behaviors, catching up with the market or branding is part of it, and research and development. I was talking to the person who was interviewing me today. We were also discussing about the R&D part in detail. We have discussed in detail that what is the kind of R&D we should be working on, we should be implementing, or we should be investing in terms of the quality of time, resource, and investment we have. So when we talk about these factors, primarily, when we talk about process orientation again has twofold. One is, am I doing the right thing to get my business on track, to get the best results out of for the business from the processes what I have, or do I need to look at? What usually happens in most of the organizations is we lay down a process, the generations change and the policies, it is something like Indian law, which is written by Britishers, and we are still continuing with the same thing with 200 rupees of fine, 100 rupees of fine, whereas the economy has grown multifold. And the same thing happens with the organization. So primarily, this thing what I've seen with the, especially with the multinational organization, what they do is every year or every alternate year, they look at their current process, they re-engineer the process, and they look at the improvements, what they can bring in, which helps the organization to meet up with the current business challenges. Well, ultimately, why an organization moves into the process? To get better results. Processes are the business facilitators and not the business blocks. So process re-engineering to me is one of the critical factors of success which will be in future. You have made a process, and if your business environment is changing, you have to change the business processes. You have to re-engineer them. You have to come up with the new organization processes, new productivity norms, new systems in place. The next is the quality. Quality holds the key. Probably, would you prefer to buy an inferior quality product? I think it is the PLS syndrome. PL syndrome, what we call it. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I thought that I am the only one who is talking and this. Okay. So it is the quality. Would you like to buy an inferior product from the market? So it is always the quality which sells. Whether we talk about, and people are willing to pay a higher price for that. Whether we talk about the automotive sector, whether we talk about your mobile technology, the same kind of features are available for with Micromax, with Samsung, with Apple. There will be a plus minus 10% of difference, but the cost association will be probably around 50% or even more. Is it not? But we buy a better quality product rather than looking at the cost. So ultimately what the organization also look at is the kind of quality system they have to put in. And people have migrated from TQM even to Six Sigma, where the number of errors they have reduced. And that has helped them in optimizing their resources and the costs as well. When the products or the services which they were providing with the same resources and a better quality or better product is being provided or better service is being provided, customers have appreciated it and customers have liked it. That has really helped them to gain the market share. Now we can talk about the technological upgradation.
Yes.
So every organization works on certain technologies, and if we talk about IT in specific, a decade back or probably 10 to 15 years back, Foxtrot was the language, which was in Indian scenario, which was private like a basic programming language, which was being used across the organizations. There was a shift in technology into migrating to Oracle, into migrating to other languages, and that's how. So it is basically when the organization is growing, it has certain requirements. But when the organization also expands exponentially, the organization, the technological needs also change for the organization to grow. So the organization also has to upgrade itself. Even the organization which was there with the SAP, their earlier version was having some limitations. So SAP has upgraded. Then the organization have upgraded. Even in some of our previous organizations, we have also upgraded to EHP6, SAP EHP6, which again is a sign that if you want to be alive, if you want to be future ready, you have to realign yourself with technological upgradations or technological changes within the organization. The next important thing is to understand the market research. Or rather the customer behavior. You have to understand the customer behavior, and people from marketing stream will understand it better, that what is the customer behavior, what is the peak period, and what are the changes which are happening in the organization or in the market segment, which talks about with the base of the market research and gives you the output, gives you the data to work about, to design your strategy. Because ultimately what we have always done will give us what we have always got. There is need to change because the customer is changing. And earlier we used to be in a seller's market. Now the market has changed from seller's market to a buyer's market. And lastly, in the internal factors, the organization needs to invest largely into the R&D part of it. Because research and development is the key to innovation. And if you just think about that, what we are doing is the best, and we do not be innovative in terms of the product or in terms of the services what we provide, we'll be stagnated and there will not be any kind of growth. Look at the basis of McDonald's, which was a burger chain from US. How they have improvised. Now you go to McDonald's, you will get paneer, you will get the Punjabi tadka, and you will get a hell of Indians, a hell of burgers to match with the Indian taste. So probably what they have done is they have improvised. They were being innovative in their thoughts. And why they have done it? They have done it based on the customer needs, what the customer expects. Similarly, like these are the internal factors which influence the success of any organization for making the organization future ready. There are some external factors as well. Something like changing business environment. What happened immediately after 9/11? There was a global economic crash. Economic meltdown. Or what happened in 2008 when AIG collapsed all of a sudden? Global giants like Enron and all AIG, global giants, have vanished overnight. And what they have done? They have caused ripples across the globe, not only in their country, their respective countries, but across the globe, they have caused economic meltdown. The currencies were off. Stock prices crashed overnight. Thousands of people lost their jobs. So the organizations would succeed. What are the kind of organizations who would succeed? The organization which can adapt quickly to these changing business environment. Like, why to go that far? We can talk about GST implementation. Into this scenario. in Indian scenario. We have implemented GST and some of the organizations which are totally dealing in cash. Our cash card now. They were the cashless companies. And it's not too far. It was just a matter of 3 months. From July we have implemented GST. Now we have 3 months. So the organization which is agile, which can adapt to the changing business environment, will be the future ready, are the future ready organization. And those are the organizations which will sustain. The next in the external factors is basically the technological shift or alternative technologies. The movement of new technology comes in, it is a big threat to the old technology. The Nokias of the world or the Blackberries. It used to be a status symbol some time back that you are not carrying a Blackberry. It is not too far. Again, it was 5 years back. 5 to 6 years back, 2010, 11, till the time 2011, 12, it was there, Blackberry. But they could not change or they could not adapt to the new technology. So they got wiped out. They were the global leaders in their technology, the kind of services what they were providing. And all of a sudden, from everywhere to nowhere, an Android, Samsung, which is nowhere in the mobile phones, picked up the market. So the organizations have to be ready for the technological change. They have to be innovative. They need to understand what is expected out of the organization. Nokia was capturing almost around 70% of the global mobile market. And for 70% in the global mobile market, it came down to almost around 10%. It lost the market share, complete market share. For external factors, it is again the risk appetite of the organization, that how much, what is the quantum of risk an organization is willing to take against the market, what is its financial standing, and whether it is recognized by the financiers as one of the leading organizations which can be provided with the financial assistance or financial support. The best of the examples in this class will be the acquisition of JLR by Tata Motors. Tata Motors, when they acquired, JLR was one of the loss-making organizations of the motors in Europe. Although it was a brand, very big, one of the biggest brands in Europe. But it was a loss-making entity. Tata Motors took it over and they have done a reorganization and now it is profitable. And now, in today's scenario, it is one of the only profitable organizations for Tata Motors, which is giving them the revenue. The next part is the futuristic thinking or the visionary leadership, which plays a critical role in the organization for the future, to be future ready, to be innovative. And this is primarily linked to that what or how the leaders of that organization sees where the organization should be on the long run. Probably 15 years back, if we have to travel, we have to lower down the window and check with someone that how to reach this place. And nobody would have thought of Google Maps. Was actually their need for Mark Zuckerberg to work on that Google Maps? But he had a thought, he had a plan. He initiated it from scratch, and which is fetching him billions now. So similarly, it is primarily you have to think about that what will be the requirement in future, not only for today. It has to be aligned to the futuristic needs of the business. And to my understanding, last in the external factors is the geopolitical environment. That plays a major role in today's business scenarios. The organization have to be ready with a contingency plan if something goes wrong. Again, I'll take you back to 9/11. After that, the entire hotel industry, entire airlines industry went for a toss, and there was nothing left for them, rather than they could have done much about it. It's a thought. So primarily, the geopolitical, like what happened to Qatar in today's environment. Qatar was has been blocked by the entire of the Middle East countries. So things are not moving for them in those areas, and the organizations probably there must be struggling. We have one of our division which is struggling with Qatar. So geopolitical environment, even to my industry, what has happened over a period of time, the oil prices, which are probably around 100 and, or rather $125 plus in the last two, three years back. I were at around $30 per barrel almost about a year back, and it is now stabilizing at around $45 to $50 per barrel. Neither the demand has reduced, and this could have been checked or controlled by the oil producing countries or OPEC countries. The production could have been curtailed, and they could have raised the prices again, but it has not happened. So it is not because it cannot be done, but it is not happening because of the geopolitical environment, primarily because of Russian oil production, or to check on the ISIS and the environment like that. And that also impacts the business around us. So primarily, the factors, the organization which will sustain or which will be successful in future will be primarily looking, will be primarily adaptive, agile, to look at they will be improvising on themselves, they will be looking at re-engineering of the organization structure, the organization processes. They will be looking at cost optimizations, and then only they will be able to be future ready and will be sustainable over a period of time. And that will be the key to the organization to be successful in the future. So what holds the key? In my view, it is the operational innovation and the way we are doing things, how we can improvise on that and how we can deliver better from the same, utilizing the similar kind of resources at a better cost. That holds the key for success. Product and service innovations, like we spoke about McDonald's. So what we can do, what is the requirement of the customer? How we can provide or how we can improvise on our current products to meet the customer's requirement largely or in a better way. That will also be one of the factors or one of the key areas which will decide the future of the organization. Well, because when McDonald's came to India, it was only selling at 20 rupees burger only, and then they improvised. How many of you would like to continue going to McDonald's if it would have sold that Mac Aloo Tikki only? So probably 50% of you?
No, sir.
More? Okay. But still, I believe that McDonald's would have lost 25%. If this is the population side, at least McDonald's would have lost 25% of the business. Yes?
Yes, sir.
So, innovation, product and service innovation is the key. What you are getting and what probably you can get out of the same resources and same propositions is the differentiator now. The next thing is about the strategic innovation. So ultimately, innovation is the key, whether we talk about the operational innovation or the service innovation or product innovation. And similarly, strategic innovation, that's what we want to do over a period of time, probably 3 years down the line or 5 years down the line. I see a revenue of 5 billion coming in, but from where that 5 billion is coming in, what will be my incremental business, what will be coming through innovation strategy about what will be coming through new product lines, what will be coming through new business lines. That decides, and that is again at the leadership level, which is being decided. So that holds the key to the business. And lastly, the innovation at the management level, or the at the top level, what we call it as visionary innovation or visionary leadership, what we talked about as Google, which is talking about Google Maps or Android or the Google itself, the search engine. Earlier, we used to buy encyclopedias, which used to cost us almost around 25,000 rupees in INR, almost from 10 to 15 years back. Google has replaced that encyclopedias, and that was basically a kind of waste paper, blocking the shelf, like no buyers for that. Even I had to sell my encyclopedia for almost around what? I bought it for 28,000 or something, and a 12 volume big, and I could sell it for 8,000 bucks. So with that innovation, management innovation, when it comes to the peak, it hampers the business environment. Whether we talk about the Blackberries, whether we talk about the encyclopedias, or whether we talk about the ring dialers, or even the PCOs. Probably 20 years down the line, the airline business maybe seen differently. Because when we are talking about the hyperloops or other transportation, even the oil and gas industry, as of now, is still a decent pay master. But probably, I don't know whether after 20 years or 25 years, with the alternative energy sources coming in, whether we talk about the renewable or the renewable energy or anything else, whether it will be required or whether it will be sustainable or not, we really don't know. There is a slightest of technological shift in an environment changes the entire industry. Now the most interesting of the topics, interesting part of this particular discussion coming on to the futuristic skills, which will be most eminent, which will be most prominent. Apart from the current skills, whether we talk about the persuasion or whether we talk about the decision making, that will probably build that continuum for future managers. But there will be a change, there will be a shift towards the latest trends at that point in time, which probably will be little different from what we are doing today, or the ways will change. Can I ask you one thing? How many of you knows mimicry? Guys, can you come up on that? Guys, we'll do a small 1 minute mimicry. And if it is not for anyone present in this room or from this college, that's a disclaimer I am putting on his behalf. If someone feels that it's similar to someone present in this room, it is a mere coincidence, not actually by default or by design. Right, guys? So before I start, let me give you one of the basics that this will be the futuristic organization work with fund. So that has to be a key skill imbibed in all of you or all of the people. Right, Faiz, all yours.
Sir, I would like to actually give an introduction. DBM sir was there. So I don't know the name. S. So he was very impatient. He used to enter into the class, he used to open the laptop, and from that only he used to start. So people were talking, I mean, there were two different sections, the people over here, people over there, used to start it. So he used to do that.
You, I'm talking to you, just shut up, I'm done with your seniors, I won't do with you, shut up, I'm done with your seniors, I can do with you, I won't have anything, so I'll tell you now, okay, this is a D, this is a B, and this is a M.
Thank you, friends. So probably we'll have it once more after I complete. Right? I wanted him basically I have been from a training background as well. So I look at utilizing the skills and more into the experiential part. What a talent, friends. Do you all agree?
Yes.
Fantastic. But now, coming back to the real part of it, when we say talent or futuristic skills, Faiz has got a fantastic skill, but how many corporates will hire him for the skill? Yes? Probably. When we have to look at the skill mapping, which is basically looking at what is my real skill and where which industry I'll suit the most. Probably, Faiz, the best suited place for you will be to be a RJ. Or maybe in a comic role in movies. That probably can be a different process. But if you like what you do, you will be really successful in that. But if you want to be in corporate, you have to learn the corporate skills. And you have to master them. Isn't that? So what are those skills? Okay, domain knowledge is one. Considering that all of you have the similar domain knowledge, all being passed out from Balaji Institute, so I consider that the domain is same. A mechanical engineer passing out from an engineering institute anywhere across the globe will have the basic requirements or basic engineering skills the same. Yes? What is the differentiator? In corporate, what we say is QSQT. How many of you have heard of it? There was one QSQT, Kayamal se Kayamal tak. There is another QSQT. When you will enter into corporate, you will realize that quarter se quarter tak. So every quarter there is a review and you have to identify first your numbers are not meeting. So ultimately, it's all about numbers. Successful managers are rated by the numbers. Successful managers, but they are not the leaders. They may be leaders, they may not be leaders. Successful leaders of futuristic skills, when we talk about, it is something about making sense, or sense-making, whatever you call it. It is primarily talking about basically the ability to determine the deeper meaning or significance of what is being done or what is being expressed. Probably the vision, how you interpret the vision of the organization is again dependent on the individual and his sense and how he applies it. What you spoke about managing the team, it's all again good, but how to manage the team? It's more about the social connectivity. We all work, we all talk to people day in and day out, talk to our team members. But how well we are connected to each other? Yeah, professionally the flow of communication is good. Otherwise organization will not work. But when we talk about social intelligence or social connectivity, is there a problem at my subordinates or my colleague's house? How well I'm connecting with others within the organization, not only with my colleagues, but with my superiors, my other peers, and that also makes difference. another very important aspect is adaptive thinking. It is basically not a problem solving approach, but it is a way of thinking and coming up with the solutions and responses. We are not, there is no right or wrong. It is not rule-based, it is defined. It is a situation that most of the leaders or most of the managers have to take decisions based on the situation. Every time there is nothing, most of the time there is nothing defined in the rule book. You have to take, and there your instinct or gut feel comes into picture, which plays a major role. Then for future managers, it will be one of the most critical aspects will be cross-cultural competencies. Probably people working in Pune and people working in Chennai, the work cultures will be entirely different. The same is the case with Delhi and Bombay. So the ability to adjust to the environment, which is entirely different, and this still is better off if you are working in different geographies, entirely different countries. The mindsets are entirely different. Probably, since I'm working with people in Singapore, Malaysia, with almost around 14 nationalities I'm being, the mindsets are entirely different. If you talk to Europeans, over a weekend, they said, bullshit, why have you called me over a weekend? Whereas an Indian, if you even call him on a Sunday, he will say, yes, sir. That's the difference. So that holds, again, one of the key, if you're working with different geographies and different cultures. Then the next critical, most critical aspect is transdisciplinarity. So you may be expert of one, but as many you grow higher, you grow up the ladder, you need to understand various disciplines. Maybe at the level of a business head, you need to understand what is happening in finance, what is happening in various other parts of the organization. You may have to deal with the people situation, you may have to deal with the financial situation, you may have to deal with customers. You need to know every I and dot of the organization. The design is one of the critical aspects of it. People should have a design mindset. It is primarily, it talks about the ability to represent and develop tasks and work processes for design outcomes. If the process orientation, we call it. If the process orientation is not there, it will be more of ad hoc as many manner of the organization. And as and when the organization grow bigger, there are all possibilities of failure. If you don't have, one of our bosses used to tell me, if you don't have a plan, you have all plans to fail and to succeed. It's better to work on plan and the processes. So you plan it well and then you execute the plan. And lastly, the virtual collaboration. Now people are working out of virtual offices, not only overseas, now in India. The concept of work from home and all have come. So it is a virtual collaboration, whether you are physically present out there or not there, but you have to put yourself out there, you have to show your presence. And you have to show your ability to work productively, drive engagement, and demonstrate presence as a member.
Right, sir. Sir, my question is related to that. 2-3 days before, in Economic Times, it came that Sarpoji Palanji is targeting for a revenue of around 30,000 crore this financial year. But the maximum, it's also given in that, the maximum profit, the revenue will be coming from outside India. So why can't it be from India? The reason for not investing in India?
30,000 crores is somewhere around $6 billion. Yeah. We are already a $5.5 billion organization. India has reached its peak in terms of the construction. So what we are looking at is we are also diversifying. As a group, we are operating across the geographies. And we, as of now, we are present, we are operating out of 42 countries in India, Middle East, Africa, and South Asia. We have, you name a country, we are present out there. So it's a kind of an Indian MNC, India-based MNC, India-headquartered MNC, which have, we also have our ambitions. Like we in oil and gas division, what we are looking at is, we are looking at projects, we are bidding for projects which are probably spread across the globe. As of now, we are bidding for projects which are almost around $5 billion. Some of them is in India, some of them are overseas. So wherever the business opportunities will be there, the revenues will flow from there. You cannot say that once I'll do business only in India and still I'll grow by 10% or 12%. If you have to grow, you have to expand. You have to reach out.
Thank you, sir. To survive in the industry, we need to go in flow with the upcoming technology, because at the end, it's all about survival of the fittest. We all are inspired by your great words, sir.